All right, here's the bell where it gets started. Be good to the sub while I'm away. If I find out that you guys have misbehaved, I will make sure that you will pay. So be nice to the sub. Do your work. Watch the video. Don't talk or cause any stinging problems. Otherwise, yeah. There's your answer for the bell work. Go ahead and start correcting the homework. We're not taking scores today, obviously, but we will next time when I return. The test also is next time on this unit. So keep that in mind. We will have a morning study session if you want to come the next time you guys have this class. We'll have it in the morning at 7:30. And here's the second page. And here's the second assignment, first page. We'll put the graphs on the next slide. There are your graphs, 4 points each. Hopefully you did that pretty good. We've highlighted kind of the center of rotation for each of these. Score those and we'll take the scores next time. All right, good job. Hopefully you guys did good on those homework assignments. This is a good time, sub, now to pass out the classworks. You can have the TAs pass those out too. These two figures are said to be congruent. In seventh grade, you learn that two figures are congruent if they have the same shape and are the same size. In eighth grade, we define congruence in terms of transformations. A two-dimensional figure is congruent to another if the second can be obtained from the first by a rigid transformation, like a rotation, reflection, or translation, or a sequence of grid. What does that say? Grid motions. If you can move one of the figures using one of these transformations or a series of these transformations so that it fits exactly on the other one, two figures are congruent. So, for example, if we took this shape and rotated it, it would have the same exact shape, just with a slightly different orientation, meaning it's been flipped or it's turned upside down kind of there. So take a moment and write down the ways in which the figures are the same and which ways they're different. And here are a few ways which they are the same and which they are different. In this case, there are several different transformations that will carry one figure onto the other. To Describe one transformation or sequence of transformations that will carry A, B, C, D to quadrilateral A prime, B prime, C prime, D prime. So I did talk about that a little bit, right? We can see that the center of rotation is the origin, and if you have questions on that, you should watch the previous lesson. And it's been rotated about the center of rotation 180 degrees. And we can see that it lies on those circles. I hope I've drawn those so you can see them. The red and black circles there. So they're the same distance away from that center of rotation. But is there a different way to do this using a sequence or many different transformations that will carry A, B, C, D to A prime, C prime, D prime? I'll take a moment and see if you can figure that out. Alright, hopefully some of you guys had that figured out. So if we look at the center of rotation, which was right here, if we draw the horizontal line there and reflect it across that line, then we would have D prime right here, A prime would be right here, C prime here, and B prime there, and that would have given us the same shape, but it's been flipped upside down, right? But that's not all that's changed about the orientation. We also need to look at the line that goes vertically through this center of rotation, which is now that purple line. Well, we can see that D and this point here are the same distance away from that line of reflection. Same with C prime and what would have been this C prime. B prime and A prime are the same. They're the same distance away, just in the other direction from the line of rotation, the line of reflection. Keep that in mind as you do these, because it will be important to see. Sometimes we can make a transformation in one type of transformation, but sometimes we can do it in two transformations, as we've seen here. So yes, it would be a reflection across the x-axis followed by a reflection across the y-axis. Or even to switch those around would be the same thing. So take a moment here and describe in your own words on the worksheet what it means to have a rigid motion, which is what translations, reflections, and rotations do. And they're motions that preserve lengths of segments and the measures of angles, meaning we don't change the size of the shape, just where it is, and sometimes we change the orientation of the shape. All right, so let's go ahead and transform this triangle ABC. We'll follow the directions that it gives us, and we'll determine whether the resulting image is congruent. So let's go ahead and take a look. Since this is a coordinate rule, or a transformation rule, let's go ahead and look at the coordinates of each of the three points. So there's our ordered pairs for A, B, and C. Now notice for each of these, we're going to take the y value and add 7. The x stays the same. So what that means is if I look at A, I'm going to keep x the same as negative 6, but I'm going to take that 3, and I'm going to add 7, which would give me 10. Well, I need to do that the same thing for each of these other ones. By the way, that would be A prime. So B prime will keep the x the same. But again, I'm going to add 10 to this, 7 to this 4, which would give me 11. I'll do the same thing with C to C prime. I've got the same x value, but I'm going to add 7 to my y value, which would be 8. Now, some of you may know already this translation is just moving this shape up 7, and that is indicated by the points on the graph as well. And there you have it, once again indicating that these have been moved up 7 spaces. Now, it didn't fit on my graph, so I hope that works out for you. We can see that this would be about 10 right here and 11 right there for B, and they have the same x values. So the next question there we can see, is this resulting image congruent to triangle ABC? Yes, it is. We can indicate that by seeing that the slopes of all the lines are the same. But really it has to do with the type of transformation that's taken place. This is a translation because all we did is add 7. We didn't multiply y by anything, which would have moved it anywhere to the negative or expanded or shrunk it. And on the other hand, I mean, you could have found the distances or the lengths of each of those sides. Once you know the angles and side lengths are the same, you know you have the same shape either way. So. But again, this is more about the type of transformation that's taken place. All right, go ahead and transform this on your paper and then figure out if the resulting image is congruent to triangle ABC, and then explain why it is or why it is not. All right, so hopefully you got something like this. We can see that this is a reflection. So the size of the shape is not changed. All that's changed is its orientation. I mean, if you wanted to, you could draw an arrow like that. So it's pointing down to the right here. Here it's pointing down to the left. And the size of these two has not changed. Again, you could find the distances of each line and the angle measure as well, and found that since that's the case, these two are congruent. But once again, it's the type of transformation that's taken place. And this one specifically is a reflection across the y-axis. We could draw the line of reflection. Well, that's kind of bad. There we go, a nice line of reflection there. Well, what about this one? Let's go ahead again, real quick, and consider our... you'll want to look at the coordinates for A, B, and C, and then use the coordinate rule to find the new corresponding image points. All right, there's all our coordinates, and again we can see why this is the case. The x's didn't change, which is why none of these x's changed. But the y's did, and how did they change? We just multiplied all of the y's in this column by 2 to get all of these new y values for a prime, b prime, and c prime. And that gives us the triangle that's drawn there on the graph. So again, the question is, are these two triangles congruent? Clearly we can see that they are not, because this length of A prime to C prime is going to be much different than the length of A to C. And since we've learned the Pythagorean theorem, we could figure that out. On the other hand though, we can see just the slopes have changed by themselves, so the angles changed also. You could go down 4 and then to the right 4, giving us a slope of this line right here. The slope is -1. On the other hand, though, this purple line, we would go down 2 and to the right 4, which is a slope of -1/2. These two slopes are not the same, therefore, automatically, these corresponding sides don't have the same slope, and it is automatically not congruent. All right, go ahead and try this one out. All right, so again, this is not a rigid motion because we've multiplied the x and y by values expanding their lengths, and we can see that in the graph. And the graph should look something like that. We can tell very clearly that that triangle is bigger, the triangle of the image. It is much bigger than the pre-image, so clearly they are not congruent. So go ahead and take a moment, write your own coordinate rule, and see if it would give you a congruent triangle to triangle ABC. And you'll want to write how you know that the resulting image is congruent to triangle ABC. And this is the nice thing, all right? As long as you have performed some type of translation, reflection, or rotation, or some combination of the three, then automatically you will find that you have a congruent shape. Now take a moment and write your own coordinate rule that is different than the ones above that would result in an image that is not congruent to triangle ABC. And then you'll want to write how you know that it is not congruent to triangle ABC. So as long as the rule is not a rigid motion, well, what does that mean? If we look back at one of the previous problems, right, the coordinate rule was xy, and it transforms into 2x, 2y. That's what we had. It was for this same triangle, by the way. So what this means is, as long as we're taking the x and y, I mean, we could switch them, right, y and x like this, which kind of represents a type of rotation. If we made one of them negative, that'd be fine. But really what happens is we have to change the length. And how do we do that? By some type of scale factor, like 3. And I mean even 10 like this. They don't have to be the same. If they're different, you'll still get a shape that is not congruent because now we've expanded the side lengths. On the other hand, if we multiplied by some fraction that's less than 1, then we would have made a much smaller triangle, so it is not congruent. So on to the second lesson. The following phrases and words are properties or descriptions of one or more of the transformations we have studied so far. Translation, reflection, and rotation. Determine which types of transformations the statements describe and write your answer on the line. An example of each type of transformation has been provided below to assist you. Here we go. All right, and here are some examples. So we can see right here that this pre-image, it's not a circle, but we can use it, has just been moved up and then to the left. Or, for example, that it's been reflected across the x-axis, and we know that from the y-axis, rather, because of the distances away from the line of reflection. But also that this shape has been rotated from the center of rotation at the origin, 90 degrees counterclockwise. All right, go ahead and take a moment to fill in these blanks. And here are the answers, and we can see that a flip is like a reflection because we've changed the direction that it's facing, right? The pre-image is kind of pointing to the left, the image is pointing to the right as a reflection. If we slide it, it's the same as taking the shape right here and then moving it around. To turn is kind of synonymous with rotating something, so hopefully that makes sense there. If it has the same orientation, meaning it's pointing to this in the same direction, then it's a translation. If it's a rotation, then we've rotated it exactly 360 degrees. And on this next one, since we see the center of rotation and some type of angle, that is clearly a rotation. If it's specified by a figure and a line of reflection, well, then we're reflecting it. If we're specified by a figure, a distance, and a direction, then we're looking more at a translation because we're moving it a specific length at a specific direction. Segments connecting corresponding vertices of image and pre-image are the same length. That is only possible with translations, and we can see in this example all of those lengths are the same. From R to R prime, Q to Q prime, P to P prime, and S to S prime. That is not always true with reflections or rotations. Property or description type of transformations, go ahead and read this one. Of course, you should know these already anyways, right? So a corresponding image and pre-image vertices lie on the same circle. That is clearly a rotation. Segments connecting corresponding vertices of image and pre-image are parallel to each other. That is true for translations and reflections as well. The line of reflection is the perpendicular, well, it said line of reflection. No real need to read the rest of that. That is a reflection. If we're looking at circles, then we're looking more into some type of rotation. If the orientation of the figure does not change, then it can either be a translational rotation. Reflections clearly change the orientation. The slopes of corresponding segments may change. That's a reflection or rotation. Corresponding segments in the image and pre-image are the same length. That can be any one of those three, right? Because they're rigid transformations. Corresponding angles have the same measure. That is true for all three as well, because again, it doesn't change the size of the shape or the angles, I guess. Parallel lines in the pre-image remain parallel lines in the image. Again, that is true for all of them. So take a moment and reflect triangle DEF over the line x equals 1, and then reflect that over the y-axis. So let's take a look at where x does equal 1. That gives me that red line of reflection. And if we look at plotting all these points, f is 3 to the left at 90 degrees from the line of reflection. So we go 3 in the other direction to find that point, f prime. E is 4 away at 90 degrees. So we go 4 in the other direction. Sorry, made that a little bit too long. At 90 degrees to find E prime. D as well. D is 6 units away at 90 degrees. So we go 6 in the other direction at 90 degrees. Sorry, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Yeah, that wasn't long enough. So this would be D prime right here. And we can connect all three of these points, and we have this triangle right here. Now we're going to reflect this across the y-axis, which is now that purple line, right? So I look, and how far away is f prime from the line of reflection? That's 4 at 90 degrees, so I go 4 in the other direction at 90 degrees to get my f prime. And I'll do the same thing with all the points. D, we can see, is 7 away, so I go 7 in the other direction. to get D prime. E is 5 units away, so I go 5 units away in the other direction. Again, these are all at 90 degrees. And that gives me my E prime. Now, technically, this has gone through 2 different transformations. So this would be F prime prime, D prime prime, and E prime prime to indicate that we have, or 2 transformations have occurred. Then we just connect those lines, and we can see both triangles after the transformation. So, and I guess it kind of told us right there how to label those. So what one transformation is the same as this double reflection? It's talking about the triangle D prime prime, E prime prime, F prime prime. What one transformation would give us that double reflection? And clearly we can see that if we moved F 2 to the left, D 2 to the left, and E to the 2 to the left, it's the same as in the coordinate rule, moving X to the left 2, but keeping the Y values the same. That is a translation. So reflect quadrilateral, quad, over the x-axis and label the image q prime, u prime, a prime, d prime. And then when you're done with that, translate q prime, u prime, a prime, d prime according to this rule and label those using q double prime, u double prime, a double prime, d double prime. All right, so let's look at our line of reflection there, the red line. And so to reflect these across, again, they should be the same distance away from the line of reflection at 90 degrees. So we should have something like this. And there we go. Now it says to translate this once again using this rule, x plus 9 and the y stays the same. So all we're going to do is move each of these 9 spaces to the right. A, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And this would be A prime prime. U is the same, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And that gives us U prime. And that gives us this new quadrilateral here. So list congruent corresponding parts. That won't be too bad. Go and take a moment to do that. And then write one congruent statement for both quadrilaterals. For all three, I guess I should say. So corresponding parts, right? We can see that QU, this segment, is congruent, and there's our congruent sign, with Q prime and U prime. Not only is it the same length, which is 3 units, but it's also congruent with Q double prime and U double prime, like this. Additionally, QD is congruent to Q prime, D prime, that line segment, which is also congruent to Q prime prime and D prime prime. Now we do have to have that line over the two letters to indicate that it is a line segment there. Continuing on with this, we have DA is congruent, that's DA, to D prime A prime, which is congruent to D prime prime A prime prime line segments. And we only have one side length to go, which is really all we're worried about. The angles are congruent, but we're not going to worry about the statement for those. The final side is, looks like it's AU, is congruent to A prime U prime, which is congruent to A double prime U double prime. So finally, the congruent statement for both quadrilaterals includes the entire quadrilateral for both of these. So, in other words, what I have first is quadrilateral quad. And this is going to be congruent to quadrilateral Q prime, U prime, A prime, D prime, which is also congruent to the final shape after the two transformations, which is Q prime prime, U prime prime, A prime prime, and D prime prime. That is the congruent statement for all three quadrilaterals. All right, and that does it for the lesson. If you want the sub to rewind it, you can have them do that. But right now is a good time for the sub to pass out the homework, which will be due next time, and next time is the test, so prepare accordingly for that.